So, can I get some reactions, some love flutters, or whatever y'all do with the
Some love.
reactions, right? For Rosalia Rivera, because she'll be discussing about how we can teach this at home with the essentials of body autonomy, consent, and boundary setting activities. So I'm gonna give it over to you, Rosalia, dropping them gems for us today.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for that welcome. I'm really excited to be here and to share how we can start practicing consent and create consent culture. That is what I am all about. This is something that I practice in my home. I will tell you a little bit about me and what I do and why I can talk about this topic at length. And I can talk about this all day, but we're going to keep it tight to this area of how we can practice it in our home, whether you're a parent or a sibling or you have children in your life that, maybe are nieces or nephews, whatever that is, we can start practicing consent and dismantle rape culture, dismantle childism, which is where we think that adults are the bosses of kids, but kids can actually really reclaim that and start to practice body autonomy, which is what I'm going to dive into today. But this is such an important topic because this is how we can empower youth to step into the world with confidence, knowing their rights, knowing how to use their voice, knowing that their voice matters, and knowing how to access help and support when boundaries are crossed, right? We want to make sure that they know that they have the right to access help and that they have the right to use their voice for that reason. And we can start practicing that from when kids are as little as 2 years old, all the way through life, right? We want to practice this between adults, right? I have to even teach adults how to practice consent because maybe they didn't grow up with it. And so when I teach parents about this to teach their kids, they are also going to go out into the world and create consent culture by having these conversations with all the adults in their kids' life. So this is all about empowerment, reclaiming your power, knowing that you have a voice, and then practicing that, right? So there's one aspect of it that's just all theory, and that's all great and good, but if we're not practicing it in those nitty-gritty ways, then what good is it, right? So I'm all about putting things into action, and so that's what we're going to talk about today. So who am I? I'm Rosalia Rivera. I am the founder of Consent Parenting and the host of the About Consent podcast. The podcast is specifically for survivors and those who support survivors. So we talk about all kinds of topics, including things like orgasm equality and reclaiming your sexual divinity. We talk about boundary repair, consent, how to create consent culture. There's so many topics, so I invite you to check that out if that's something that you're interested in. But with Consent Parenting, which is the platform that I use to teach parents, how to step into educating their kids about abuse prevention in a confident way. I teach them about how to talk about these topics, about body safety, boundaries, consent, abuse prevention. And I do it in a way that is coming from an empowered place, not a fear-based place. When I grew up, and I'm 42 now, I grew up in a home where I wasn't allowed to have boundaries. I wasn't allowed to use my voice. I grew up in a very strict Catholic home where it was all about do what you're told, don't make a fuss. If any of you are Latinx, you know the term calladita es más bonita, which means, when you're quiet, you're prettier. And so I am all about shattering that and saying, no, our voices matter and our voices are, they deserve to be heard, right? And so that applies to children as well. And that's one of the things that I teach as part of consent education. So I actually was just today teaching for the first time a workshop to a group of toddlers. I usually teach parents. But what was really interesting is that, kids grow up just typically in a normal home setting, believing that they have to listen to authority, they have to listen to their parents. And while that is, of course, important in many aspects as it relates to health and safety, when a toddler's crossing the street, you don't want to just let them cross the street on their own. You want to hold their hand. They might not want to hold your hand, but you realize that for health and safety reasons, you have to hold their hand at whether they like it or not to cross the street. So in those cases, when it's related to those specific kinds of things, of course, we want to make sure our kids are, you know, doing what they're asked to do, holding their, you know, holding the adult's hands, going to, you know, take the medicine that they need to take or whatever it is in those health and safety pieces. But as it relates to all these other things, we want to teach kids that body autonomy matters. And so that's the foundational piece of consent that a lot of parents will tell their kids, you know, your body belongs to you, because they want to, you know, champion the whole, you know, abuse prevention, don't, you know, go off with strangers kind of thing. But what we're talking about is those daily practices. When we tell kids your body belongs to you, we have to honor and respect that. And so that's what I teach parents as the foundation to abuse prevention. So let's break down consent as it relates to kids and how that will, you know, travel with you through life, right? As you get into relationships, as you go into, you know, dating someone, how are those lessons that we learn early on going to impact the way that we interact in relationships? So the foundations of consent are actually something that most people don't teach their kids, right? It starts with understanding what body autonomy is. For a lot of people, they've never heard that term. Body autonomy basically means your body belongs to you. Inherently, as a human being, your body is your private property, and only you should be allowed to say what happens to it and with it, right? So that term, my body, my rules, my body, my autonomy, my rules, my boundaries, right? So the next step of that is talking about boundaries. And boundaries, you know, when we talk about that with kids, we typically think, well, okay, so if grandma, you know, if I don't want to give a hug or a kiss to grandma, I get to say how and, you know, how and when that happens. And that's starting to now finally come around. But in many homes, especially the one that I grew up in, I was not allowed to, you know, say who I wanted to or not wanted to hug or kiss, right? It was like, if you didn't go and give grandma a hug or your uncle or whoever it was, you know, a family member, if you didn't give them the appropriate greeting, then you were going to be considered rude. And your parents probably didn't want you to, you know, didn't want to come off as raising a rude kid. So they would say, go and kiss so-and-so and go, you know, go do this, go do that. And so when we tell kids your body belongs to you, but then we're telling them go kiss somebody that they may not want to, we are giving mixed messages and we're not reinforcing what it means to have body autonomy. And those boundaries that we want to teach kids to be able to uphold, we have to be able to uphold them on their behalf and to model that, right? So what does that look like? That looks like telling grandma or grandpa, hey, we're not, you know, making Leah, you know, hug or kiss anyone anymore. We're not forcing them to do that. They get to choose how they, you know, hug and how they want to hug and kiss you, or if they even want to do that, how they want to greet you. If it's a fist bump, if it's a wave, if it's a high five, they get to choose, right? They get to set their boundaries, their rules. So beyond that though, right? Most parents are like, okay, that's easy enough. We can do that. But what about all the other stuff, right? As it relates to what you want to wear, or, you know, if you want to eat everything that's on your plate, we're telling kids eat everything on your plate means I get to tell you what to do with your body and I get to tell you when you're full. And I know that that goes against what most of us have been grown up with, right? How we've been raised. Mm-hmm. So breaking these patterns is really important, right? Being conscious of the messages that we send our kids with how we tell them what to do with their body. That can even mean if I don't want to have a haircut because I want to grow my hair long, but my mom wants me to have short hair, then, you know, that is actually me imposing my will over your body, right? Of course, when it comes to, again, to health and safety things, we want to make sure our kids, you know, are being hygienic and that they're, you know, be eating healthy. So we can place certain rules around it, but we still want to make sure that we are honoring their boundaries around it. So we can serve the food that's healthy, but it's up to them to choose how much of that they're going to eat. We're not going to give them snacks later or candy because, you know, they didn't eat their food. So that's how we set those parameters as adults, as parents, as caregivers, as stewards of their health and safety, right? But ultimately, we want to make sure that we're respecting that. And that takes more work as a parent. But ultimately, in the long run, it pays off because when our kids are teens and adults, they're going to understand that their body truly belongs to them and that nobody gets to tell them what to do with it. So that's how we set the stage. We want to make sure that we're teaching about body autonomy. We want to teach them about how to develop their boundaries, right? So that means if you don't want to hug and kiss, you can choose, right? You set the rules for how you physically interact with other people. That's what that comes down to. And then consent is that permission piece, right? Is that vocalization of someone requesting that access to you, requesting to cross that boundary, and you deciding if you are going to allow that or not. Now, most people will teach this as your body, your rules, you get to have a choice, but then they don't practice it on the daily. And if we're not practicing it on the daily, we're giving mixed messages and we're not giving our kids the opportunity to actually vocalize, right? And we know that kids learn by repetition. They learn by practicing. The better you are at practicing piano, the better you're going to be at playing a song, right? So it's the same thing with consent. We need to make sure that we are practicing walking the walk, not just talking the talk, right? And so what does that look like? It looks like always asking, always practicing the act, you know, the act of asking for consent. So with a three-year-old, that might look like, you know, do you want to play a tickle game? If you don't want to play that, you know, I'm not going to just start tickling you because I think you're so cute that I got to go in for a tickle. I'm going to be respectful and ask. And if you say no, I'm going to respect that. And you can practice it in the same way backwards, right? So some consent activities that you can do are playing a game where it's, you know, for a younger kid, it could be something like going back and forth with a may I game. So a may I game looks like my child is sitting next to me on the couch and I say, okay, we're going to play the may I game. So may I touch your knee? And they may choose to say, yes, you can. And okay, I know I can touch your knee. Now it's their turn and they ask me, may I touch your shoulder? And I can say, well, I don't feel like, you know, having my shoulder touched today, but you could touch my hand. And so we're giving them by modeling that the example of how we can give options to what our boundaries are. So if I don't want anybody touching my shoulder, but I'm okay with my hand, then now they understand that boundary, right? And so we can play that back and forth. And also even them hearing a no is actually really powerful because regardless of gender, we want this to be a two-way conversation. It's not just about me upholding my boundaries, but also about understanding how to respect the boundaries of others, right? And so when we practice games like this, we also practice them vocalizing and hearing a yes or a no, or maybe, maybe later, maybe tomorrow, maybe not today, you know? So knowing and understanding that consent is fluid, it can be reversed, right? So if I say, yeah, I'll hold hands, and then a minute later, I decide, you know what, I don't want to hold hands anymore. That's okay too, right? With consent can be withdrawn. And that's something that I wish I had learned when I was 17, when I was in a relationship that went south because that person did something that I didn't consent to, but I had consented to at first and then decided not to. And I didn't know that I had the right to withdraw consent. So it's really important that we teach this early on and we can do these through these practice games, right? So those are just some examples that we can start with. But then the next thing that we want to talk about is also helping kids practice that with friends. They can practice it within, you know, siblings. Like if there's people at home besides just the parent, it's really another way for them to always practice that and to listen, right? So we want to make sure that they are tuning in and that they learn about other ways that they can read body signals, right? So sometimes if they're scared about something, what are some other ways that they can show that they're not interested in that interaction? So giving kids all of these tools to practice it, to say it, to hear it, to feel it are really key for them to be able to go off into the world and practice that with other people. Now, a lot of times they will come off into the world, go off into the world without understanding that others may not know about this, right? So it's also key that we explain, Not everybody understands consent. This is actually something quite new for a lot of people, right? So whether that's family members or friends or whoever it is, they may not know what consent means. So sometimes we need to educate people, and that's okay. And that's why using your voice matters, right? So that's us encouraging them to communicate, to be able to speak openly and know that they can speak up regardless of who it is. And this is really important because typically in the world, you know, you have adults who believe that children should blindly obey authority. So they think that, you know, I can tell this child what to do and they need to obey. So when we send them off into the world, our kids understand consent. We've been practicing it at home. Now they go off into the world and the teacher is like, wait a minute, this child is not, you know, listening blindly, like there's no blind obedience here. So this is one of the opportunities that we can take to be parents and advocates on behalf of our children and talk to those people that we know are going to be interacting with our kids regularly to educate them. So in my program, In Consent Parenting, for example, I've created what are called consent letters. And you can create these in your own life. You don't need these templates that I've created, but essentially what they are communication tools, right? Because when our kids are starting to learn this and they're just starting to practice it, we have to be their advocate, their ally. We have to speak on their behalf at first to make sure that those adults in our children's lives also understand what we're practicing at home. This is how we create consent culture. We don't want to just send our kids off into the world and say, all right, you got to do this job. We have to do that job for them first, which also models to them how it's done. We model those boundaries for them, and then they learn, oh, that's how they talk about it. That's how they do it. So an example of what these consent letters look like is, perfect example is even just for a doctor, besides a teacher, right? So I have consent letters for teachers, for doctors, for coaches, for babysitters, for relatives. Everybody in our child's life who they interact with regularly should know about these practices so that they can start to implement those and be educated about consent, right? Because again, we live in a rape culture. We're trying to convert this to a consent culture. And we do that by speaking up so that our children understand that they can speak up, right? So what does that look like? Well, a consent letter for a doctor would go something like this. Hey, we're practicing consent education in our home. And we know that, you know, you've been a great doctor, our family doctor for a while. We just wanted to let you know about this, you know, new practice that we're doing. And we are teaching our kids about consent. And we would love for you to be an ally in this. So this is how we practice it. We always make sure that we ask our child for consent before anything. So in relation to, you know, a medical visit, please, you know, when you interact with them, let them know what it is that you need to do, why you need to do it, and how you need to do it so that they are informed. This is informed consent. So they're informed about what you need to do, why you need to do it, and how you need to do it. And then you need to ask for consent. And hold up, you gotta wait to hear their answer that they agree before you proceed. Now, typically, just as a side note, if you're thinking, well, if my child's got to go for a, you know, a vaccine and they don't want to get a needle, like what am I going to do if they say no? Well, you're going to role play with your child ahead of time because this is what falls into a health and safety situation, right? So we're going to go to the doctor, we're going to get a vaccination. This is probably how it's going to go. The doctor's got to ask you for consent because they can't just do it without asking you first. And so because this is a health and safety situation, you know, this is a vaccine, we need to do it for XYZ reasons or whatever that medical procedure is, right? Whether it's an eye doctor, an ear doctor, whatever, you know, this is why we need to do it. So will you consent to that? Because, you know, it is important. And so this is where we practice communication with our kids to let them know so they can start to develop their own critical thinking skills. Oh, okay, I realize that this is important for my health and I do need to do it. And you can even say, I may need to override it in this particular case because it is a health and safety situation, but I want to let you know what to expect. And when it comes to a doctor in particular, it's really important that we own our medical, you know, our medical process, right? We don't want to get into situations where our kids go off into the world and they don't understand their reproductive rights, their medical rights. You know, all of these things are related to consent. So when we start to practice it in these ways, we are telling our children, even with a person of authority, you still have the final say. You still get to choose, right? Again, with younger children, as it relates to these health and safety pieces, we have to make those calls for them, and we want to inform them. Again, always informing about consent. But this is how we start to practice it, right? And so the doctor waits for the child to consent. If they say no, then in the letter, it says, you know, we're going to discuss it and we're going to talk about it. If we need to come back, we may need to come back. If not, we've already discussed that we're going to get it done and we're going to get it done. But this is how we start to communicate, right? And we let our child know what's up. We let the doctor know what's up. And there is a, we're creating consent culture through that process. As it relates to teachers, similar thing. If my child gets hurt, this is how it would go. This is how we practice it at home. You know, there is only in physical interaction with consent. They get the final say. They get to choose, right? So we let those adults know we are empowering our children about their body rights. We're practicing this at home. And we hope that you are going to be an ally in this. So we're not trying to call people out about this. We're trying to call people in and to say, we want you to be part of this consent education that we're teaching. So we are advocating on their behalf. We're teaching our kids how to communicate about those boundaries. And then, of course, we're teaching our kids that this is what we're doing, how we're doing it. We're teaching the adult, this is what we do at home. This is how we need you to do it and respect those boundaries. And this is how we create a safer community, whether it's at school, whether it's at the doctor's office or at a sports team, wherever it is, right? So getting into the practice of that is a lot harder than just being like, your body, your rules, right? We want to make sure that we are literally putting this into practice in lots of different ways, right? So ultimately, when we wrap it up and we start to put these pieces in place, we may find that there's some bumps in the road because, you know, our child may say, well, I don't want to, you know, take a bath today, my body, my rules, right? And so this is where when parenting, we have to practice some patience and some communication. So more than anything, this is where we slow down and go, okay, I don't want to repeat the patterns that I grew up with. I want to give my child the power to say, yes, your body is yours and you get to say. Here's some things to consider though. You might not be, you know, you might go to school smelling a little, or you might, you know, not, if you don't want to brush your teeth, you're going to get some cavities, or you're, you know, it's going to, you're going to start to not be able to get any candy because you're not taking care of your teeth, right? So there are ways that we can communicate to give them information that's going to empower them to make better decisions about their body, right? We're empowering them with these things. Giving them information lets them become critical thinkers about the fact that you have this responsibility about your body. I'm helping you make better decisions so that you have a healthy and safe life, right? And how this acts out as they get older, right? When they get into relationships on their own, is that they have now been practicing how to say yes or no, how to set a boundary, how to be able to uphold that boundary. If somebody says, you know, you didn't want me to kiss you, but like, what if I hug you, you know, and they try to cross that boundary in another way. And the child has had enough practice to say, wait, hold up. Like, this is not okay. I didn't say no, just so you could try to convince me. I said no, because I need you to stop. Right. And if they've had this practice ongoing throughout their young lives, when they get into relationships, they are not afraid to speak up. And that's why it's so important that we practice it from as young of an age as possible, because this is something that needs to be ongoing. These conversations aren't just about reading a couple of books here and there. They're not just about, you know, saying this nice catchphrase, your body belongs to you. It's really about honoring that and teaching them that they have the right to use that voice. So when we are, you know, dealing with kids that are getting into older ages, and we're talking about, you know, as it relates to even online exchanges, if a child knows how to set those boundaries, they can stop something before it becomes unsafe. They can report it. They can talk about it. They know that they have allies in you as the parent to back them up and say, this happened, it made me uncomfortable, the person didn't want to listen, I voiced my boundary, they still tried to cross it, I didn't like that. Where do we go from here, right? And they come to you to know that you're the safe adult who's going to always believe them, who's going to back them up, who's going to stand by their boundaries and help them stay safe, right? So these are the different ways that we can really come together as parents to create safer communities. And ultimately, at the end of the day, if we aren't practicing this, we can't expect our kids to go off into the world and just magically be able to do it, right? And a lot of times we tend to think that if we are, you know, telling them these empowering things, that should be enough. But again, if they're not practicing it, they're not going to be able to do it in a situation that is awkward or uncomfortable or is full of peer pressure, right? All of a sudden, there's all this peer pressure that they've never been able to practice how to say no to something. So that's one big part of it. And then the second part of it is creating a safety network for them, right? And so again, this is all about allyship. So let's get together a group of people, whether that's 3 to 5, you know, safe people in their lives who are those additional backup people. A lot of times when kids get into awkward or unsafe situations and they are afraid of what that consequence is going to look like for a parent, because maybe they made a mistake. You told them, you know, don't talk to strangers online. Don't make friends with people you don't know online. Don't send pictures you're not supposed to send online, right? And you've set these parameters and they know that they shouldn't be doing those things, but maybe they got pressured into it, or maybe they decided that that person, they really liked them and they wanted to, you know, do something to prove that they really liked them, even though it didn't feel totally right. And they lowered their boundaries, even though they've been practicing it. Now they're not going to go to mom or dad because, well, they might get mad because they told me not to do it, but I did it anyway. And now what do I do? Well, this is where safety networks come into play and where we want to make sure that they have other lifelines. Because sometimes somebody might say, well, if you tell your parents, they're not going to like you, or they're going to be mad at you, or they're going to disown you, or whatever lies an unsafe person might say, then that person may feel trapped if they feel like they don't have anyone else to go to. So I always encourage parents to create safety networks as early as possible, typically from the age of 5 and up, and kids can incorporate, like they can choose who else they want to be part of that network. So 3 to 5 safe people. And we want to define for them what a safe person is. So a safe person is defined by 4 major things. First is that they would never break a body boundary. So if you say no, they have to respect that and they stop right away. Another quality of a safe person is that they would never ask you to keep a secret. Secrets are things that make us feel icky. They make us feel uncomfortable or off, right? And even if they ask you to keep a good secret, it's not a good idea to keep a good secret because they may be able to use that later as some kind of extortion, you know, like, well, you kept this gift I gave you, or, you know, you went on this, you know, to get ice cream with me and we didn't tell your parents, but if they find out, right? And that was a good secret at the time, but now it's not so good of a secret. So secrets are not a good thing. And anyone who asks to keep a secret is not a safe person. So a safe quality of a safe person is that they would never ask you to keep a secret. So that's 2. 3 is that a safe person would always believe you no matter what. And that's something that as survivors, we all need. I'm a survivor and I wish that I had safe people in my life that I could have said, I wish that I could go to someone that will believe me, because my situation, I didn't tell because I didn't think people were going to believe me. So I didn't tell anyone. So having a safe person means that you have at least one person who you know guaranteed will always believe you. That makes them a safe person. And then the 4th quality of a safe person is that they will do whatever it takes to keep you safe, right? So if that means removing access to a particular person, or being able to report it to someone so that that person can no longer have access to you, whatever that means and whatever it takes, they will do what it takes to make sure you're safe, right? So those are the 4 qualities of a safe person. And those are the type of people that you want to have in your safety network. So when we're creating a safety network for our kids, those are the qualities that they have to have and that they have proven, right? So we don't want to just say, oh, you know, grandma's going to be a safe person or auntie's going to be a safe person. They have to prove by using those qualities that they are safe people. And that's how we can include them in a safety network. So we create the safety network so that if in the event that you have, you know, done all of these things that are right to, you know, teach them about autonomy, teach them about boundaries, teach them about consent, practice it, talk to the people in your kid's life, you know, give them consent letters or, you know, have those conversations that are hard, whether it's with your family members or outside of your home, and something unsafe still happens, which is possible, very possible, that they know that if they can't come to you for whatever that reason is, that they have other lifelines so that those situations do not repeat and that those situations do not escalate, right? So we want to make sure that we are keeping our kids as safe as possible by giving them those resources. Now, beyond that, beyond knowing, you know, what those safe people are, we want to make sure that they have access and that they are keeping those people up to date. So what that looks like is that, you know, they have their contact information, that these are people that can actually connect with them, right? So if something happens and they're in a location that they need to get out of, that person has a way to get to them to, you know, rescue them out of that situation or to make sure that, you know, they can connect with them one-on-one so that they have that access to them, right? They don't need to go through a parent to connect with that person. And then that person is also going to bring in the, you know, the right people. So whether that's a parent or law enforcement or whatever it is. And we also want to make sure that those safe people know what the right protocol is for disclosure. Because a lot of times you can re-traumatize someone if you ask them the wrong questions, if there's any kind of, you know, doubt, you know, if the child senses that you doubt them or that there is some kind of blame or shame being put on them. So we want to make sure that we're creating a safety network of people that also know how to deal with a disclosure. What do you say? What questions do you ask? You want to make sure that they know how to support their your child, right, in how to handle a disclosure so you're not re-traumatizing anyone. It won't impede a potential investigation or anything like that. So there's a lot of pieces that go into this, and it's not to say, you know, you don't do it or don't feel overwhelmed by it, because I certainly don't want you to walk away with that. It just means that this is something that we need to take into consideration, to do step by step, to learn as much as we can about it, because these are the things that will help us create more consent culture, less rape culture, to dismantle that, to believe survivors, to give them the right support, to make sure that we are supporting them in all the different ways as we can, so that these situations do not get out of hand, that they don't end up in, you know, child trafficking or in other situations that are ongoing that later on end up creating things like complex, you know, CPTSD or PTSD, right? We want to make sure that we are giving our kids all the tools possible to stay safe. So I know that was a lot. I covered a lot of different things from, you know, how to teach consent and practice it in our homes and some activities that you can do to creating a safety network and how you build that out and giving, you know, having these conversations in your community, because the stronger of a community that we have, you know, that has an understanding of consent, the safer that your child is going to be. But what I want to leave you with more than anything is that this is a process. It's not something that's going to happen overnight. It's not something that is going to, you know, just change, especially if you didn't grow up with it, especially if that wasn't the way that you were raised at home. I certainly didn't grow up that way. And for me, with my three children, I have three young boys between the ages of 5 and 9. I want to make sure that not only do they understand about their boundaries, but that, again, they know how to respect the boundaries of others and that they understand that this is a two-way conversation, that they can speak about it comfortably when they get into relationships and they know how to ask somebody, you know, would it be okay for me to do this? Or how do you feel about that before you proceed with something, right? And that they understand that it's okay to communicate and they don't feel shame about even asking. Because I know that it's, you know, for some people, they think it's weird if you ask, it's gonna mess up the mood, or it's, you know, going to be like really, it's going to make me look weak if I have to ask, because we, you know, again, are raised in rape culture, right? What we see in the media doesn't reflect what we're trying to create in consent culture. So we want to make sure that we're teaching the right things and we're practicing the right things, and that we're giving all of these messages throughout their childhood, right? As they are toddlers to kids to teens. So from toddlers to teens, we can be practicing this throughout their life. We can have conversations. We can look at media and be critical of media about the messaging that our kids see. So it doesn't have to feel like these conversations are heavy. It doesn't feel like, you know, we are having to sit down and teach this like we're in a classroom. It's really about making it practical, conversational, and more than anything, try to make it fun and part of your family dynamic, right? I always say, we want to make sure that we're teaching this, like we're weaving this into our parenting. This is just part of our parenting now. It's not a thing we have to do or a thing that we teach. It's just part of our parenting. So it's really about breaking down childism and believing that our kids do, you know, they deserve that respect, and they deserve to practice those rights that they are born with, that we're all born with, and that's how we're going to actually prevent these kinds of situations of abuse and the next wave of Me Too, right? We're trying to prevent that from happening. And we can all do that. We can do that with people that, you know, aren't necessarily even our kids, right? Our kids' friends. When they come for a play date or when they're hanging out with their friends, right? Openly talking about it and asking the questions. Have you heard about consent? Do you know what that is? You know, we were teaching that the other day, or we saw this movie where there was somebody who was definitely not practicing consent. Did you see that scene? Did you, you know, have you seen that movie? Did you, you know, read that book about XYZ? And, you know, this character was like definitely not practicing consent. What did you think about that, right? So there's lots of ways that we can mix this into our conversations with kids without making it into like a classroom lesson. It's really about practicality. So I hope that that gave you some ideas and some insight as to how we can start to change, you know, the culture in our home to one of consent culture that really empowers our kids, really empowers our families, and even changes the way that adults think about it, who may not have, you know, who raised us differently, who, you know, may think that it's maybe ridiculous, right? They might challenge it, and that's okay. When we practice our boundaries as parents and adults, we show our kids how to do it, and we can do it in a way that is kind and calls people in and creates allyship. And if there are people who don't want to respect that, well, now we know who we can't necessarily trust or who we can't necessarily rely on to help us empower our kids. And that's okay too. We're not trying to change other people. We're just trying to educate the world. And hopefully those people who become educated will also become those allies that we can see create further consent culture. So I would love to know what your takeaways were, if you wanna put those in the chat. I think there were some questions. I don't know if it's time for us to ask questions. Oh, okay. So yeah, I just read Michelle. It says, please feel free to chime in and ask anytime to questions. Perfect. So is it okay for me to ask some questions, like to answer questions? I think we may have like 10 minutes left.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, awesome. Okay, so let me see. I don't know if there were some at the top. All right, just going through here. Okay, Liza says, I love that you said that, because part of consent is being informed. If anyone has questions, please ask. Okay, what type of discipline do you use for your children? How does consent play into that discipline? Yeah, so that's a great question. And it's something that I get asked a lot, because again, you know, it's like, if somebody doesn't want to do something or they flat out refuse, then what do you do, right? And again, for me, it comes back to this conversation of, first of all, making that switch. Having the conversation with your kids in the first place to say, we're going to start practicing consent. And what that means is that I'm going to ask you to do things instead of just telling you to do things, right? So you may decide that you don't want to do it, but I'm going to have to educate you about why I think it's a good idea that you do it. And if you still decide not to, well, these are going to be the consequences of that. So you don't want to brush your teeth? well, we're not going to be able to do any sweets anymore, because the consequences of that are you're going to have more cavities. We're going to have to go to the dentist. You may need to get, you know, your teeth pulled out. Like, so for me, it's about educating them to say, these are going to be the natural consequences of what's going to happen if you make that decision, which you have the right to make. Now, I know that that's a lot easier for an older child. For a toddler, you may, you know, not be able to implement those things right away, but you can listen to them, right? And you can say, okay, I understand you don't want me to change your diaper, or I understand that you don't want to have a bath. We do need to have a bath at a minimum this number of times per week, right? So you have to, first of all, set those parameters around what is health and safety in your home. Everybody has different definitions of it. Do you have to decide what that looks like in your home and then set those parameters? I'm not saying we don't have boundaries for our kids at all. We do need to have those boundaries when it comes to health and safety, but you need to decide. And for, here's an example. I had a parent who reached out to me and she said, my daughter doesn't want to have her hair cut. And I, you know, I think that she needs to have it short, you know, shorter than what it is. And I said, well, is it because of health and safety? Like, is it because she doesn't want to wash her hair, or is it because you want her hair to be short? Because if it's more about an aesthetic thing, then are you respecting her autonomy of how she wants to wear her hair? If it's about health and safety because she's not washing it, well, then you have a reason to say to her, if you're not going to take care of your hair, then we're going to have to cut it shorter so it's more manageable for you, because that's a health and safety situation. So you have to make that call, and you have to decide for your family what that looks like. But as it relates to discipline specifically, if, you know, somebody hit somebody in the home, you know, there was a sibling fighting, and like, you know, that's not okay because you're crossing boundaries there. You're hurting somebody that is not safe, and we're going to need to separate you, you know, and what that looks like in your home is individual once again, right? So you have to decide, okay, is that going to mean that you're going to be in another room so that you can think about what you did? So this is where I always tell people, you have to decide on what your parenting values are around discipline and punishment. I would never, you know, obviously never recommend any kind of corporal punishment, like, you know, no spanking or hitting, obviously, but you have to decide what that is going to look like. You can set the boundary there and say, absolutely no hitting, that's not okay. And if you're going to keep trying to do that, I have to physically separate you because you're not being a safe person. Meant,
like, is it so mom of me to be like,
sorry, say that again. Oh, I don't know if that was a question. Okay. So that's essentially, you know, how I would deal with that and decide like what that particular consequence is going to be for that action, but definitely separating them, making sure that they're not hurting each other, and that you explain, you cross that boundary, that physical boundary with someone, that's not okay, right? So that's how I would answer that. Okay, so I'm going to move on to the next question. How would you apply your education to families who are against premarital sex? I'm thinking of situations in which teenage girls are fearful of having these conversations with parents because maybe they have had sex and they are not supposed to. So again, I mean, I think that this is an individual home topic. I am one that is a pro, a sex positive, pro, you know, sex education parent. So I think we need to be having those conversations in the home. If there are parents who do not want to have those conversations, that's actually putting their child in greater harm because they're not having those conversations. But I'm trying to understand a little bit more your question. It says, I'm thinking of situations in which teenage girls are fearful of having these conversations with parents. I think for, there's someone who's got their mic, and I don't know who it is. If everyone can just check, because I'm getting a lot of background noise. Okay, so I'll just keep going. So I think that in those cases, it's important for kids to reach out to safe adults. You know, again, if they can't speak to a parent about certain things, they don't feel safe having those conversations, then they can look for other safe adults that they can have those conversations with. And this is why I encourage parents to create those safe spaces. So I'm not sure if I'm answering your question, if you can maybe clarify, because I'm not sure if I'm understanding what you're asking completely. So I'm going to move on to the next question, if there is one. I'm not sure if there is, but If you can clarify that a little bit more, that would be great. And I can help answer that. I answered it. Okay. All right. Great.
Real quick. I'm so sorry. I just want to remind people, if you are on this call, unless you have a question, we really need you to ensure that you have your mic on mute because we are getting quite a bit of feedback.
I think that's Hannah who doesn't have the
mic.
Okay, there you go.
So thank you so very much. Thank you.
All right. So I think that was it. I don't see any other questions. I don't know if there was anything else, Michelle, that you had wanted me to touch on, but I think that was it.
I would love if you could tell people where you are. And I apologize, for some reason I wasn't able to mute anybody's chat. So if you could just tell people, where can they find you? Tell us about your podcast before we close out, and just kind of let us know where we can find you.
Yeah, for sure. So the platform that I teach about parenting and consent and all these things is consentparenting.com. You can also find me on Instagram. It's one of my favorite places to hang out. So Instagram handle for that is also consentparenting. So pretty straightforward. And then also on Clubhouse, I am at About Consent. So if anybody's on Clubhouse, they can find me there too. And then for my podcast, the podcast is aboutconsent.com. That's the website where you can find those, or on any podcasting platform, you can find About Consent. And again, that's where I talk about all of these topics, not necessarily just parenting, but also how we can end rape culture. And Michelle is actually going to be one of the guests that's coming up. So definitely tune in, because that's one of my favorite episodes. And you can also follow me on Instagram. The handle for that is About Consent Podcast. And I definitely, of course, talk about the episodes that come out. I post episodes every 2 weeks. And, you know, lots of great interviews. Most of them are interviews. And I'm speaking to experts in mental health, trauma survivors who are thriving. I consider myself a thriver, so I love talking on that topic, especially of how survivors can really reclaim their power and become thrivers as well. So you can find all of that through that platform. And I'm also, you know, always on Facebook doing lives as well, and I have a blog. So tons of ways that you can find information, and my DMs are always open. So if anyone wants to reach out and has questions, feel free. I have workshops and a membership. My membership is going to be opening up soon as well. So if anyone's interested, the membership is specifically for parents who are survivors of child sexual abuse, who want to be able to teach this and break the cycles with their families. So that membership is specifically for those kinds of parents, but all parents are welcome to learn about my work through my workshops and through the content that's free and available through all of my other channels.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
No, thank you so very, very much. We really, really appreciate you. So go ahead and make sure you check her out and go to aboutconsent.com and really find out about her, and stay tuned and make sure you follow at About Consent. And at this point, we are going to take another break. You want to be sure you're taking some time, getting some water before we start the next presentation. And we will get started right at 4 o'clock. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Bye, bye-bye. Everyone. Bye.